The majority of the biggest acts in the world have a tether to celebrity that we don't. Like, we can go and walk around and not get recognized everywhere. It's kind of cool, because I don't enjoy that aspect of it. We are a fans band. We truly have a fan kind of army at this point that surprises me, amazes me. And I think that's the most important thing, the reason we're still a band, and the reason that we continue to find inspiration, it's our fans. That's why we're here.
We were here in South Africa 7 years ago, but as an opening band. So the accomplishment that's coming back here is for us, is that we feel like we've sort of earned our way now to be here.
We've had little failures all along the way from the very beginning, making mistakes, three steps forward, two steps back kind of a thing. And so South Africa, it's a milestone for us.
Seven years ago, we were still the opening act, trying to make a name for our band, trying to be known, trying to be heard, and now we're the closing act. South Africa is one of the most beautiful places in the world, and to end your tour again here, it's kind of bookended, you know? Everything we did in between has led us to this.
It's been really strange over the last 10 years of our career. It's gone in a direction that is easier to just ignore than it is to try to make any sense of.
So I want to go back to the beginning. Tell me about your upbringing in Oklahoma. How would you describe it?
I would describe it as quintessential Midwestern Bible Belt, buckle of the Bible Belt. I was surrounded by very warm, well-meaning, wonderful people. It was as normal an upbringing as you could possibly have. I was playing music the entire time, playing piano, playing guitar, playing drums, playing everything. When I was 17, 18, and I started writing, I really started writing a lot. When I look back, I'm like, oh my God, I can't believe I actually wrote that. But as bad as they were, the songs that I wrote had a kind of vastness to them in terms of commerciality. From the very get-go, my songwriting was never going to be anything but accessible. And it was in high school that I had a couple teachers approach me and tell me, you know what, I think you could actually do this.
Tell me the story of how you and Ryan met.
I moved around a lot in my life. Soccer for me was like the only way I could really get into the various groups that were constantly changing. So I gravitated instantly to the soccer team. And senior year, Ryan joined the team. So we start hanging out, and almost the first topic that he will start to talk about is music. So it was just kind of an instant, like, musical connection, really. And our senior year, him and I and, like, four other friends got together, and we played a song in the talent show. We didn't win. But that right there was important, though, because after the talent show, we had this quote-unquote meeting in the school library, and I instantly recognized that most of the people in the group were, like, not very serious about the whole thing. And Ryan and I were like the ones who were like, I think we can make this happen. So after we moved to separate places, him and I would talk on the phone, and I was listening to kind of like the beginning of his songwriting. So I always knew that like he was determined to fulfill anything to the fullest, and I was kind of the same way.
At that point, I knew I wanted to be a musician. So the summer between junior and senior year, I started looking for an internship, and I got a hold of someone at DreamWorks record label, and they offered me an internship. That's how I ended up in Nashville.
Hope when you take that jump, you don't feel the fall. Hope when the water rises, you built a wall.
So I go to Nashville, and I get a job waiting tables at a Planet Hollywood. I'm on my second day of training, and I walk in. There's a poster board that says, NSYNC, win a record deal, Planet Hollywood. That's all I saw. And I'm walking out, and I ask the manager, I'm like, so what's the deal? What's this about? He's like, new audition, and whoever wins goes on MTV. They're having a competition, and whoever wins wins a record deal. And he goes, but read the fine print. He goes, you're not eligible. I go, why? He goes, you're an employee of Planet Hollywood. And I go, are you kidding me? And he goes, yeah, if you work here, you can't audition. And I looked at him, and I go, I quit. So I went in and I auditioned, and 2 weeks later, I get a phone call saying, hey, could you be in New York? You won the Nashville portion of the competition. So I went to New York.
Give up for Ryan Tedder.
Is it possible maybe to have a love so strong that nothing could ever compare? I'm holding back nothing just for the look in your eyes.
So long story short, all these people came in doing cover songs, all these like fake boy bands like put together in 2 days. But I had a song that I'd written and I ended up winning the entire thing.
I'm holding back my thing for the look in your eyes.
Ryan Tedder is a winner. Congratulations, Ryan. Nice work. Now, how does it feel to be the first to be signed to Freelance Entertainment? It's psyched?
I have nothing to compare it to. It's awesome. It's awesome.
The next day, we read the fine print, and it turned out that it was, you win the possibility of a record deal. And so that's what I won. And I got a check for $125. I don't know what that was about. They handed me a check for $125. When I won.
Amazing, amazing job.
Well, keep up the good work. We're going to be expecting to hear a lot from this guy right here.
Oh, yes, we are.
So a month goes by. I don't really hear much. I get a random call from a guy who's now one of my business partners and one of my closest friends. And he says, buddy, you remember that record deal you won? I said, yeah. So whatever happened with that? I said, nothing. He said, well, Timbaland was watching. Timbaland, the single biggest disruptor of modern music in the last 20 years. And he signs me to a production deal. It was like a quasi-record deal. I end up bouncing between, for the next year and a half, Nashville, Miami, where I'd spend months, New York, where I'd spend months. So I'm producing at this time, doing remixes for different artists, whatever I can do. It just wasn't the right thing yet. So after a year and a half straight of that, my deal's coming up to an end, and Timbaland realizes I don't want to be a solo artist. And he goes, what do you want to be? So I'm like, I don't want to be Justin. I don't want to be John Mayer. I don't want to be all these guys with guitars. That was really big in like 03, 04. And I said, I listen to Oasis. I listen to the Pixies. I listen to U2. And I want to be in a band. So long and short of it, after about 18 months of being signed to Timbaland, I decided to call Zach.
I was living in Chicago at the time. He was kind of bouncing back and forth between Nashville, New York, and Miami because he had just started like working with Timbaland. And you know, as we were catching up, he was like, someday we gotta make this happen, man. So we had all these conversations, and finally it really came to a head.
I said, what do you think about, and this is what I love about Zach, what do you think about dropping everything you're doing and starting a band? He said, really? Are you serious? Yeah. All right, give me a day to think on it. And like the next day he calls me back. I'm in. This sounds amazing. Why the hell not? Let's do it.
So he sold everything he owned and packed all of his music equipment, everything in his car. And I did the same for us. It was like nothing happens outside of LA.
and we're going. First thing we noticed was that it's not as easy to get a gig in LA as we thought it would be. We thought we'd call someone and we'd say, oh, Ryan like worked with Timbaland once, and they'd say, oh great, here's a whole tour for you in LA, you know? It was the complete opposite of that. We had to really work our asses off, and that's where the band came into the picture.
Yeah, we moved to LA and came up with the idea of OneRepublic and quickly put together a bunch of great guys.
We're OneRepublic.
It was like, this is exciting, let's do it.
It was strange for us because we had come from these different backgrounds of strong, supportive local music scenes, and we didn't really know what to do to nurture the same thing in a city as big as Los Angeles. We've had several attempts that were probably pretty fruitless now that I think about it. Flyering on Sunset Boulevard and trying to harass people outside of different places and basically going wherever we could find a crowd.
Building the following in Los Angeles was incredibly difficult. In the history of the band, it's up at the top with the hardest things that we've ever done. I started calling every single venue that I could think of in Hollywood. I called Viper Room, I called the Roxy, I called the Whiskey, I called it the Mint, the Gig, the Brown Derby. I was calling everybody. You know, hey, hello. You know, what the hell do you want? Da, da, da. I was like, can I send you some songs? No, I don't give a shit what you sell me. Well, how many tickets are you worth? You know, it was a nightmare.
We put the music that we had on MySpace, and we could kind of blindly message college kids and say, hey, I saw your profile, and it seems like you're into some really cool stuff. We're going to play at your school. You should tell as many friends as you can.
So the MySpace thing started rolling. We were touring up and down the California coast, and we'd go do a show in San Diego, and we'd have 45 people show up that have never seen us because I was spamming the hell out of them before I knew what spam was. And then it started building. It just started building.
The turning point for us was the residency at the Key Club. We played each Thursday for a month. And the first show, there was like 20 people. Second show, there was like 80 people. By the third show, when I called the promoter, she's like, oh my God. And I remember this conversation because she's like, I don't know what's going on, but you guys are killing it.
All the shows that we were booking started selling out, and we were selling out of merch all the time. So we're getting this kind of buzz happening. We had some independent offers. Epic Records, Columbia, Hollywood Records were the three that circled around us, and Interscope. It came down between Columbia and Hollywood, and we ended up signing with Columbia.
I'd be the first to welcome you to Coachella.
So we're signed to a major label. We just got a huge opportunity to play at Coachella. We were basically on cloud nine, you know? And as we were driving to Coachella, our manager called and said, Columbia has decided to revamp their artist repertoire, and you guys are not gonna be a part of that. At that point, I had been in LA for I think almost 3 years, and I was married, and I didn't have a degree, and I was starting to really feel like I was making a mistake with the band. And so I told him, like, man, I think I need to just give this 6 more months. And after 6 months, if we're doing the same stuff, I gotta go back to Chicago and I gotta get out of here, because there's only so long you can tell your wife the band's gonna make it, you know, before you really start to feel like a parody of yourself.
It was It was just a weird situation because we were on this high from Coachella and then we just went to this instant low. And in my head, I'm like, oh my gosh, you know, I was kind of freaking out. I didn't want to let them know about that, you know, that I was freaking out, but I was losing it inside.
When I find out we're getting dropped, I'm furious. I go to my apartment, I get online, I go to MySpace, I change our status from signed to unsigned, and I don't think anything of it. Well, one of the girls that works in the MySpace office one day decided to take Apologize and make it her track of the week. Well, that exploded. Within 6 months of being dropped, we were getting over 100,000 plays a day on the MySpace player. We were the number one unsigned act on MySpace. It's too late to apologize.
That was huge. That was like, okay, you know, the guy in the suit that works on the 10th floor of whatever building in LA thinks that we don't have it, but what is it about? It's about fans. It's about people who want to listen to your music. And there was people all over the world at that point who were messaging us saying, I love your song.
And I've never actually told this in an interview, but before I moved to LA, before OneRepublic really started, I had Apologize for 4 years. And in the spring of 2003, I sent it to Timbaland, and his response back was like, you have to finish this record, you have to finish it now. I'm telling you right now, this will change your career. So he was watching MySpace religiously every day, looking at the top artists. And he saw us sitting there at number one going, wait a minute, that's the dude, that's Ryan. That's the dude that I signed like 4 years ago.
So he got a hold of Ryan and was like, I'm releasing this album of collaborations and remixes and stuff, and I want to remix Apologize and sign you to my label. At that point, all of us were like, a remix on a hip-hop album or whatever you want to call it, we don't care. You know what I mean? What else are we going to do? The only thing that seemed to be working was MySpace and all the other things that were new and different and unexplainable.
We said, that's fine. You can remix it as long as you don't put it out as a single. This is our single. So labels, yeah, we're not gonna put it out, don't worry. The album came out, radio stations started playing it before they even announced what single was first. And within the first week, the number one selling song on the album, just from iTunes, was Apologize. It was unstoppable.
I'm holding on your rope, got me 10 feet off the ground. I'm hearing what you say, but I just can't make a sound. You tell me that you need me, then you go and cut me down. But wait, you tell me that you're sorry, didn't think I'd turn around.
At that point, man, I was working at Coca-Cola, filing papers and answering phones. And feeling this big. So I remember the days when we got emails saying, like, you guys made it in the top 40, Timbaland's remix, you know? And I'd go on my computer and I'd see it, I'm like, holy crap. And then every 2 or 3 days, you know, like, you guys are in the top 20. And then it just went all the way up the charts.
It's too late.
But there was pros and cons to the way that we did it, that we broke into the world. The cons were obviously that, like, nobody had a clue who the hell OneRepublic was. I mean, what was it? Nobody knew anything. OneRepublic could have been one guy, it could have been like a boy band, it could have been, who knows?
I knew that we were in trouble, when the first interview we did in Germany,
we walked in, all five of us,
and the disc jockey looked up. She said, kind of startled, "Oh," in a thick German accent, "Oh, it's so shocking. I had no idea you guys were a band. I thought you were a boy band." I was like, "What?" She said, "Yeah, featuring OneRepublic. I thought it was the name of, like, a boy band." For us, like, a bunch of guys who had been, you know, a year before playing Coachella as an alternative rock band, to hear someone say, "I thought you might be a boy band," it just deflated us. And at that point, I said, "Guys, this is fun, but if we don't have another successful song off of this first album, if this is a one-hit wonder scenario, we're done." Yeah, I'm holding on your own, got me 10 feet off the ground.
Throughout our career, there's always been a series of, if this doesn't happen, it might be over. You know, if we don't book a show at the Knitting Factory, it might be over. If we don't get signed, it might be over. If we don't, you know, et cetera, et cetera. So for us, one of those points, one of those steps, was whatever song we released after Apologize, that was a make it or break it moment. If this song tanks, and we're really known for just a remix, and we really are a one-hit wonder, you know, the end has already begun. This town is cold enough, I think it's sick of us. It's time to make a move, I'm shaking off the rust. I've got my heart set on anywhere but here. I'm staring down myself, counting up the years. Steady.
Stop and Stare was so different than Apologize, than the remix. And bottom line is, every instrument on that track is live. It's us playing in a studio. It sounds like a band. And that was what we needed to get across.
Exactly, yeah. I mean, Stop and Stare for us was a game-changing sort of song, you know? This was not a remix. This was the exact opposite of a remix. There's a crazy guitar solo in the bridge, you know? But I think it started to confuse people even more, you know? What is this? Stop.
Stop and Stare actually did really well. So when that song reached its climax, we knew that, like, we were gonna stick around for at least another year or two.
Even though Apologize and Stop and Stare were huge hits, I was like, if anything, super cynical about OneRepublic. My perception is that the mass majority of humans on Earth are going about 99.9% of the time not giving a rip about you. And there are artists that operate under the assumption that everyone is waiting for their next thing. That's not me. You know, I'm a pragmatist. I'm not just a blind optimist. So I thought, I can't put all my eggs in this basket of this band. Then right around that same time, my back catalog of songs were getting cut by different artists. And I was having all the success as a producer outside of the band. Trying hard not to hear, but the talk so loud. Their piercing sounds fill my ears, try to fill me with doubt. Yet I know that the goal is to keep me from falling. Hey, hey. An unknown artist, you know, X Factor winner in the UK, Leona Lewis, put out a first single, which I'd written and produced, and it was called Bleeding Love. So I remember getting a call from Simon Cowell. "Ryan, congratulations. We just broke a record. First week sales shattered the Beatles record." Some crazy record that Bleeding Love broke in the UK that week, and it's number one. It's gonna be a huge hit everywhere in the world. Keep bleeding, keep bleeding. Ninety days later, Apologize followed it. It literally went Bleeding Love number one, taken over by Apologize number one. And the combination of those two then created a kind of a tidal wave for me as a producer. I was better known as a writer-producer than OneRepublic, particularly because of Adele and that whole series of 2 or 3 years. You know, it created a very much a tug of war between OneRepublic and my other life as a writer-producer. And I did have, if I'm being honest, in the back of my mind thinking, man, there will be some people, like some peers of mine, seeing what is the project, you know, what's the OneRepublic thing? This guy, what's this gonna do? What's this gonna sound like? And that was really the only eyes I thought that might be on us, other than our fans, was people waiting to throw rocks at me. And then, kind of out of the blue, U2 asked us to open for them. Now, this is their 360, largest tour in the history of the world, stadiums with the space station in the middle. Nothing bigger was happening on Earth than U2's stadium tour. And we worshiped U2. So for us, this was huge.
This is a very proud moment. Thank you to OneRepublic for giving us liftoff. Thank you very much to them.
After the third concert, their manager, Paul McGinnis, came into our green room, which he never does with opening acts, and gave us this 20-minute speech saying, I saw something tonight that I've seen only a couple other times in 30-some-odd years, and I'm telling you, you guys have it, and this is absolutely what you're meant to be doing, and it should be way bigger than it is now.
Holy shit.
So I finally felt that we've had enough forward thrust. Like, if you're trying to get to the moon, right, do you have enough fuel to get there? Well, we finally had just enough fuel in the engines to actually make it to the moon, and that's why I stopped everything and decided to focus almost entirely on OneRepublic.
Million miles, million dollars, but you can never spend it his way.
Woo! Okay, last one, here we go.
My goals with the album, Native, were to beat anything we had ever done, thematically, musically, on every level. So something that resonated with the world on a much larger scale than anything we had ever done.
We just thought, like, this has to be a good one. You know, this has to be the right album. And we're gonna put a lot of time into thinking about it and a lot of back and forth. Some songs had 5 versions of them. But we felt like it was a voluntary pressure and not an expected pressure. And I think that's why we really dug in.
The third album was so important to me that the only sessions I took during the making of Native was to work on Beyoncé's album. Ironically, it was in pursuing a song for Beyoncé, I got inspired by another song that immediately turned into Counting Stars.
I see this life like a swinging bar, swing my heart across the line.
Counting Stars is not only, you know, the biggest thing that we've had, but 100% us, no remix, you know, more than any other song, was the song that made people realize who we were as a band, what we've done as a band over the years, that all of those albums are ours, and all those songs are ours, and that our name is OneRepublic. You know, this is the song that connected all the dots.
To me, the most magical part of Counting Stars is that the lyric is a great unifier, is kind of the pinnacle of that desire to make everybody feel united under something that everybody experiences.
Right when Counting Stars was at its peak, there was a turning point in the middle of the tour. We were playing amphitheaters, and I just remember there was a completely different atmosphere that was starting to take shape, you know, with these shows, and people were engaged a lot more than they ever have been.
We'll be Counting Stars. Oh, oh, oh. Take that
We're in South Africa, the end of this epic global two-year tour on the album Native. What does the future hold for the band?
I think the future holds a bunch of unknowns. How do you re-inspire yourself and do something that surprises yourself and surprises the world? Because just having hits, that's not what it's about for us. You know, there are a lot of bands that have made storied careers off of just copying themselves. We're the opposite of that. So it has to be something surprising.